As Britain and the Allies struggled for survival in a fierce battle with the Nazis, American industrial might was mobilized to supply them with the weapons and machines to beat back the German onslaught. Millionaire Howard Hughes was anxious to participate in the war effort to do his part to defeat Hitler. His intentions were not completely altruistic. A military contract would also have been extremely profitable. Hughes built the prototype D-2, a speedy wooden fighter/bomber, entirely with his own money and in secret. He hoped to amaze the U.S. Army Air Force with it, but the plane was flatly rejected. Fortunately for Hughes, he had friends in high places. When President Roosevelt declared war on December 8, 1941, he had not only to consider the fate of the free world and the lives of millions of American soldiers, he also had to weigh the risks to his own sons. Elliot Roosevelt was a member of the U.S. Army Air Force. He had received his captain's commission on his 30th birthday in 1940. At the time, Roosevelt was battling for a third term in office, and there were cries of nepotism. But General Henry Hap Arnold, chief of the Air Corps, silenced those rumors. Elliot Roosevelt's poor eyesight left him classified as 4F, or unfit to fly, but he still managed to carve out a respectable career, participating in 89 combat missions. Reconnaissance was his specialty, and he was considered the leading expert in recon in the European theater and a pioneer in aerial night photography. While commanding the 3rd Reconnaissance Group in Operation Torch, the invasion of North Africa, Roosevelt had a chance to fly on board a speedy de Havilland Mosquito. He was so impressed with de Havilland's wooden wonder, he became a passionate advocate of British aircraft and believed American-made B-17s and P-38s were sitting ducks against the German defenses. His enthusiasm may have blinded him when a sly Howard Hughes presented him with a prototype for his own wooden aircraft, the D-2. The D-2 was a twin-boom fighter just like the Vultee Swoosh Goose, designed by Hughes' former employee Richard Palmer. Palmer left Hughes for Vultee because he was tired of the company's lack of focus. The D-2 also had a remarkable resemblance to the P-38 Lightning. They were so similar, Hughes did not believe it was a coincidence, and he testified to the Senate that Lockheed had stolen his design. Though the D-2 had been rejected by the U.S. Army Air Force, when Colonel Elliot Roosevelt came to town looking for a new reconnaissance plane, Hughes dazzled him Hollywood-style to salvage a contract. The P-38 Lightning had been the workhorse reconnaissance plane for the U.S. Army Air Force, but by 1943, they were looking for an upgrade. Colonel Roosevelt, an expert in recon, was asked to explore what aircraft were in the works that might take over for the P-38. Hughes spared no expense when Roosevelt came to see his plant in Culver City, California. A line of limousines greeted the president's son and his staff at the airport, and they were taken on the trip of their lives. Women and starlets were thrown at them. They were treated to Hollywood's most extravagant parties in the hottest nightclubs. A married Roosevelt was introduced to his next wife, Faye Emerson, an up-and-coming actress with whom he would have a scandalous affair. In the midst of all this partying, there was time to see the D-2. Its Duramold body, a type of plywood bonded with plastic and molded under heat and pressure, would certainly have impressed Roosevelt, who was enamored with a Mosquito. By the time Colonel Roosevelt left California, he was sold on the D-2. He became an enthusiastic salesman for Hughes when he briefed General Arnold and his father on the project. Arnold was in a difficult position, as Material Command had already rejected the aircraft. They did not believe Hughes had the facilities or track record to deliver on an order. In the end, Arnold had no choice but to listen to the president's son. He ordered the XF-11, an all-metal and larger reconnaissance version of the D-2. The decision caused an uproar in the Army Air Force. Not only because the D-2 had been rejected, but also because they already had a similar plane in development, the Lockheed Chain Lightning. The XP-58 was a long-range heavy fighter which could outperform the D-2, and it came from a known and reliable aircraft and manufacturer, the P-38 Lightning, built by Lockheed. Uproar or not, Elliot had his father's ear. Hughes won a $43 million contract to build 100 XF-11s, a contract that would be worth $500 million today. Unfortunately for the Army Air Force, their worst fears about Hughes came to be. Work progressed slowly on the XF-11. Each of its Pratt & Whitney 28-cylinder radial engines drove a pair of contra-rotating four-bladed controllable pitch propellers. It was hoped this style of prop would increase performance and stability, but the whole system was too complex and ultimately scrapped. As years passed, the XF-11 project, forced on the U.S. Army Air Force, became increasingly unpopular. The original D-2 prototype was mysteriously destroyed in a fire in November of 1944. At the time, Hughes and the U.S. Army Air Force were fighting over who should pay for the original development costs. With the prototype a pile of ash, the two sides agreed to split the costs. It was an accident which was highly convenient for the millionaire. Like the XF-11, controversy followed Colonel Roosevelt as the war progressed. Project Aphrodite was a joint mission between the U.S. Navy and U.S. Army Air Force to destroy heavily fortified German submarine pens and V-2 sites with bomber drones. The pilot and co-pilot would take aircraft heavily loaded with explosives to altitude before parachuting to safety. A mothership remotely controlled the bombers the rest of the way via radio. In later years, Elliot Roosevelt claimed to be in the Mosquito chase plane that recorded the tragic death of Lieutenant Joe Kennedy Jr., brother of future President John F. Kennedy. His plane inexplicably detonated before it reached its target. Elliot asserted that he actually flew through the deadly fireball that ensued, but there is no record of the president's son participating in the mission. There was also some controversy when Roosevelt was finally awarded his wings. General Arnold, who had been forced to accept Hughes XF-11, also had his arm twisted to intervene in Colonel Roosevelt's final promotion. In January of 1945, Arnold ordered General Carl Spatz to appoint Elliot, whose poor vision had left him classified as 4F, or unfit to fly, as a rated pilot. The president then submitted his son's name to the Senate for promotion to Brigadier General. On April 12, 1945, America mourned the death of President Roosevelt. He had accomplished much during his tenure, guiding them out of the Depression and through the war. As tragic as his passing was, it did untie the hands of General Arnold. He was finally able to put millionaire Howard Hughes in his place. The XF-11 order was canceled a month after the president's death on May 11, 1945, though Hughes was allowed to continue to work on the prototypes. By the time the war ended, Hughes still had little to show for all the money spent on the XF-11. It would be another year before a prototype would fly, and the first flight ended in a crash that nearly killed him. The XF-11 was not Hughes's only multi-million dollar scandal. His behemoth transport, the H-4 Spruce Goose, was more of a lame duck and was yet to fly. With millions of dollars poured into both projects, questions swirled in the Senate about what Hughes was doing with the money. In 1947, the Brewster Committee looked into the spending irregularities surrounding these projects.
I've put the sweat of my life into this thing. I have my reputation rolled up in it. And I have stated several times that if it's a failure, I'll probably leave this country and never come back, and I mean it.
Elliot Roosevelt and Johnny Myers were also called as witnesses. Myers, a publicist who worked for Hughes, gave a detailed expense report of all the perks Roosevelt had received during his time in California.
Well, now, can you tell me why you were charging up to aircraft production $132 for a nylon hose for Miss Emerson.
Because she'd been very charming. Just like the presidents up higher. The girls were very pleasant.
What has that got to do with aircraft production?
They just went along. Every company in the business did it. We're no different.
Well, but is it... You say because she was very charming, that's the reason that you charged up $132...
That's right.
...for the... which would go into the production of airplanes.
That's right.
And now, will you tell us why you gave her $20 and charged it up to the company to go home if she was very charming?
Well, she... You tapped me. Listen...
Myers had even paid for Roosevelt's wedding to Fay Emerson. In his defense, Roosevelt claimed that he first heard about the XF-11 after the Culver City visit in a briefing from Arnold.
And there are efforts to find out whether there was any connection that I might have had with the chief executive which might have had an effect on any war contract. And I'm here to give you the complete facts. It is undoubtedly true that he bought some tickets to from New York to Washington. But I still want you to put the question to him, was he completely positive that one of those tickets was for Elliot Roosevelt?
Well, I'll put it right to him now.
Mr. Myers, what do you say? Look at that sheet. You told us about them being lost and buying the fares back. Now, what do you say about it?
Just what it says here. It says Colonel Elliot Roosevelt party.
Yeah.
So I didn't testify that he was one of them. He could have been one of the other fellas. Did I say that under the word Elliot Roosevelt party?
During a break in hearings, Hughes decided to give the Senate all the evidence they needed that the Spruce Goose was fit to fly. While taxi testing the aircraft, he took the H-4 on its first and only flight. In daredevil fashion, Hughes proved to the cameras and reporters that the millions of American tax dollars had not been squandered or misappropriated. The millionaire used his Hollywood dazzle to save his own skin.